Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for standing by. Welcome to Alibaba Group's June quarter 2020 results conference call. At this time, all participants are in a listen-only mode. After management's prepared remarks, there will be a question-and-answer session. I would now like to turn the call over to Rob Lin, Head of Investor Relations of Alibaba Group. Please go ahead.
Good day, everyone, and welcome to Alibaba Group's June quarter 2020 results conference call. With us are Daniel Zhang, Chairman and CEO, Joe Tsai, Executive Vice Chairman, Maggie Wu, Chief Financial Officer. This call is also being webcast from our IR section of corporate website. A replay of the call will be available on our website later today. Now, let me quickly cover the safe harbor. Today's discussion will contain forward-looking statements. These forward-looking statements involve inherent risks and uncertainties that may cause actual results to differ materially from our current expectations. For detailed discussions of these risks and uncertainties, please refer to our latest annual report on Form 20-F and other documents filed with the U.S. SEC, or announced on the website of Hong Kong Stock Exchange. Any forward-looking statements that we make on this call are based on assumptions as of today, and we do not undertake any obligation to update these statements, except as required under applicable law. Please note that certain financial measures that we use on this call, such as adjusted EBITDA, adjusted EBITDA margin, adjusted EBITDA margin, marketplace-based core commerce adjusted EBITDA, non-GAAP net income, non-GAAP diluted earnings per share or ADS, and free cash flow are expressed on a non-GAAP basis. Our GAAP results and reconciliation of GAAP to non-GAAP measures can be found in our earnings press release. Unless otherwise stated, growth rates of all stated metrics mentioned during the call refers to year-on-year growth versus the same quarter last year. In addition, during today's call, management will give their prepared remarks in English. A third-party translator will provide simultaneous Chinese translation on another conference line. Please refer to our press release for details. During the Q&A session, we will take questions in both English and Chinese, and a third-party translator will provide consecutive translation. All translations are for convenience purpose only. In the case of any discrepancy, management statement in the original language will prevail. With that, I will now turn the call to Daniel.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining our earnings call today. We have delivered another strong quarter. Although the global community continues to struggle with uncertainties surrounding the pandemic, we have seen encouraging signs of recovery in China. Due to effective management of the outbreak in vast majority of the country, COVID-19 has accelerated digital transformation of consumer behavior and enterprise operations. Alibaba is a key beneficiary of this development, with most of our businesses, including core commerce and cloud computing, have recovered and resumed healthy growth. The pandemic has fundamentally altered our macroeconomic environment and everyday life, but it has also introduced new opportunities. Digital adoption and transformation is the prevailing trend in this changed landscape, and we are confident that we can create Alibaba's future by capitalizing on the opportunities in this challenging environment, just as we did in 2003 during SARS and in 2008 during the global financial crisis. In the 12 months ended June 2020, annual active consumers on our China retail marketplaces reached 742 million, representing a quarterly net increase of 16 million. Mobile MAUs on our China retail marketplaces reached 874 million, an increase of 28 million since March. These numbers reflect Taobao's continuing strong consumer mindshare, healthy user stickiness, and engaging user experiences as the world's leading consumer community. Tmall online physical goods GMV excluding unpaid orders, grew 27% year-over-year, with all major categories growing at a similar or faster rates relative to December 2019 quarter. Our unparalleled product offerings and engaging user experiences contributed to higher purchase frequency as well as higher average spending per customer across all city tiers that increased both year-over-year and quarter-over-quarter. In terms of user acquisition, we continued to increase our penetration in less developed markets. Taobao Deals, our new mobile app targeting value-conscious consumers, reached 40 million MAU in June. The disruption in international tourism presented an opportunity for our import commerce business. Tmall Global, the leading cross-border import platform in China, grew over 40% year-over-year in GMV, excluding unpaid orders. Looking forward, our China retail marketplaces will focus on the following areas. Number one, continue to drive user acquisition, especially in less developed markets, and work towards reaching our midterm goal of serving more than 1 billion Chinese consumers. Number two, continue expanding our product supply, especially in categories currently under-penetrated by e-commerce. And number three, continue to enhance the shopping experience and the path to purchase on our platforms through new content formats, such as live streaming and short videos. Our investment in new retail over the past several years have well positioned our grocery business, Free Shipple, Tmall Supermarket, and Taoxianda to capture unprecedented growth opportunities during the pandemic and continue to see healthy growth momentum in the past quarter. More than 60% of Free Shipple's GMV came from online, and the stores which has been in operation for more than 1 year, enjoyed double-digit same-store growth. Tmall Supermarket's half-day delivery services, which leverage certain store-based inventories, gained widespread popularity among consumers and helped SunArt increase consumer reach and create incremental sales. We enabled approximately 15% of SunArt's total revenue during the June quarter. Ulama successfully rolled out an important branding upgrade in July. The new brand proposition, "Anything You Love, We Deliver," represents the transformation of Ulama from a food delivery platform into a comprehensive digitalized local service platform. In addition to food and beverage, Ulama now also delivers everyday necessities such as grocery, fresh produce, medicines, and flowers from local merchants. In the June quarter, Ulama achieved positive unit economics as a result of improved operational efficiency. It also resumed positive year-over-year GMV growth, signaling healthy recovery of the business. We also saw promising early-stage results in Ulama's strategic cooperation with Alipay. During the past quarter, approximately 45% of new customers ordering food delivery on Ulama was contributed by the Alipay mobile app. We will further deepen the cooperation, and we believe there is significant potential for value creation by combining Ulama and the power of entire Alibaba ecosystem to capture opportunities that will emerge from the ongoing digital transformation of the food and beverage and the retail industries. We will continue to invest in this area. Lazada continued to show strong progress in the last quarter, with order volume growing more than 100% year-over-year. The pandemic has significant impact on many South Southeast Asian countries, and it has converted many consumers into online shoppers. We believe the increasing adoption of online shopping is beneficial for healthy growth of the region's e-commerce industry over the long term. Southeast Asia continues to be the strategic priority in our globalization strategy. In this highly competitive region, with Lazada's new leadership in place, we aim to build a sustainable digital business leveraging Alibaba's technology to serve local consumers and business partners. During the June quarter, AliExpress, our cross-border export marketplace, saw order conversion and the delivery time negatively impacted by challenges in cross-border logistics. But the situation has started to improve in July. Alibaba.com and 1688.com, two of our oldest businesses, saw new market opportunities this year. Many international wholesalers have turned to Alibaba.com to source products from China as global supply chains were disrupted and Chinese factories were the first to resume production. In June, daily active buyers on Alibaba.com increased over 100% year over year. 1688.com also saw more than 50% year over year growth in daily active buyers as a result of increasing number of SMEs, especially small retailers looking for supply as Chinese economy reopened. The pandemic has also transformed the way enterprises work, accelerating demand for cloud infrastructure and services. According to IDC's latest report, Alibaba Cloud maintained its position as the largest public cloud service provider in China, which is a testament to Alibaba Cloud's strengthening market leadership. In the June quarter, our cloud computing revenue grew 59% year over year. In sectors such as internet, financial services, consumer retail, and public services, Alibaba Cloud not only provides infrastructure as a service, but also develops industry-specific technology and business solutions to address real-world application requirements for our customers. As offices and schools reopen in China, Dingtalk's DAU moderated from the peak level, but remain over 100% higher than pre-COVID-19 levels. Approach to work and education have changed fundamentally, and Dingtalk will be the important digital collaboration platform for working and learning moving forward, connecting all industries to services on cloud. For our digital media and entertainment business, Youku's daily active subscriber base increased by more than 60% year over year during the quarter with the release of popular TV series and variety shows. In July, cinemas started to gradually reopen in China, and Alibaba Pictures has been preparing for business to resume. We are closely monitoring the pace of recovery. Recently, we decided to stop the operations of UCWeb and other innovation initiatives in India after extensive review of the business. We don't expect it to have a material impact on the group's overall financial performance. Today, we face uncertainties from not only the global pandemic, but also increasing tensions between US and China. As the world's largest e-commerce platform, Alibaba's primary commercial focus in the US is to support American brands, retailers, small businesses, and farmers to sell to consumers and trade partners in China, as well as the other key markets around the world. We believe global trade will continue and Alibaba's active pursuit of our mission to make it easy to do business anywhere are fully aligned with the interests of both China and the United States. We are closely monitoring the latest shift in U.S. government policies towards Chinese companies, which is in very fluid situation. We are assessing the situation and any potential impact carefully and thoroughly, and will take necessary actions to comply with any new regulation. Now, I will turn it over to Maggie, who will walk you through the details of our financial results.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight. I'd like to review our financial highlights for June quarter. We delivered a very strong start to our new fiscal year. Mobile MAUs in June was 874 million, quarterly net adds of 28 million, and annual active consumers was 742 million, quarterly net adds 16 million. We continue to acquire new users and consumers from less developed areas of China, reflecting our ongoing success in broadening product offerings to meet different demands. The purchase frequencies and spending of our consumers coming from less developed areas also continue to improve. Our total revenue was 154 billion RMB, up 34% year over year. The increase was mainly driven by the robust growth of China commerce retail and cloud computing businesses. Our domestic core commerce business has fully recovered from the COVID-19 impact and showing strong growth. Cloud computing revenue grew 59%. Our free cash flow in June quarter increased by 39% to 36 billion RMB. Our strong profit growth and cash flow enables us to continue to strengthen our core business and invest for longer-term growth. Now, let's move on to revenue in details. China commerce retail grew 34% year-over-year. Customer management revenue grew 23%, primarily due to increased revenue contribution from search-related revenue as well as new monetization formats. This new format includes recommendation fees and things like live streaming. We see number of paying merchants and spending per merchants both increased. Commission revenue was up 17%. Commission revenue growth was primarily driven by solid 27% growth in Tmall physical goods paid GMV. The gap between the growth of commission revenue and Tmall physical goods paid GMV growth was mainly because of faster growth in FMCG and consumer electronic categories that have lower blended commission rates, and also because of our initiatives to support our merchant customers, including our waiver of annual service fees for first half of 2020. Revenue from Cainiao grew 54% year-over-year. This was primarily caused by the fast growth of our cross-border businesses such as Tmall Global, supported by increased adoption fulfilled by Cainiao services. Revenue from local consumer services was 7.1 billion RMB, up 15%. This is due to an increase in average order value and ongoing recovery in on-demand delivery GMV growth. Unit economics per order for the non-demand delivery businesses was positive during the quarter, reflecting improved delivery network efficiency as well as enhanced marketing efficiency that leveraged our consumer insights technology. This has led to further narrowing of losses year over year for the local consumer service. Our merchant acquisition continued to accelerate for this local consumer services. Ali Cloud continued its strong growth, so we show 59% year-on-year growth in revenue, and at the same time, the losses continue to be narrowed. So our average revenue per customer continued to improve, and all the cloud services across are growing very well. So for DME and innovation initiatives, one thing worth to mention about is that our online gaming business, which was developed from acquired businesses, has been growing well. So it is not recognized as part of the DME segment. It grew into sizable revenue and user scale and was moved out of the incubator, which is the innovation initiative segment. Let's take a look at our cost trends. Cost and expense growth generally kept pace or was slower than revenue growth, reflecting ongoing improvement in operating efficiency. The savings from operating efficiency improvements were reinvested into strategically important businesses with strong long-term growth potential. Let's move to segment reporting. We continue to enjoy solid revenue growth by segments. The strong profitability coming from the core business enables us to invest for the future. For the core commerce segment, market-based core commerce profitability grew strongly to 55.5 billion RMB, up 8.7 billion RMB year on year. Developing businesses such as local consumer service, Lazada, New Retail, and Cainiao all showed strong operating performance and improved operating efficiency. The combined losses of these development businesses was narrowed by 1.5 billion RMB to 4.2 billion RMB, which contributed to the 25% EBITDA growth of the overall commerce segment. Cloud computing, we talked about the loss margin was narrowed to 3%. For digital media and entertainment, we continue to focus on reducing losses in Youku through content cost control while increasing paying subscribers growth. Losses reduced by about a billion RMB year on year to 1.3 billion for DME segment. Innovation initiatives and others. The increase in losses were primarily due to our investment in FinTalk businesses and also AutoNavy for the user expansion as well as the technology research and innovation. So overall, our business continued to deliver strong profit growth with improving efficiency. At the same time, we use our incremental profit to continue to invest back to our business. So June quarter free cash flow and CapEx, our businesses overall continue to show strong profitability and cash flow. As of June 30th, cash equivalents and short-term investments were 382 billion RMB, which is over 50 billion US dollar. For the quarter, free cash flow was 36.6 billion RMB, which increased by 39%. Mainly due to our robust profitability growth. So June quarter other financial metrics, the share of results of equity method investees in the quarter was 349 million. We record our share of results of all equity method investees one quarter in arrears. Thus, for this June quarter earnings, we're recognizing our investees' March quarter share of results. But you can tell that the Ant Group has performed well in March quarter. The COVID-19 pandemic has caused widespread disruption to the economy, which has and could continue to impact our investee companies. So June quarter gap to non-gap net income reconciliation is shown on this page and is self-explained. So looking ahead, China has managed the pandemic and the whole process is managed very well and the economy recovered very quickly. So our group has benefited from the overall China's recovery as well as the accelerated digitization of our customers. Our core and new businesses all developed well. This allows us to have multi-engine drivers for the revenue and profit growth. Our strong profit growth will make it possible for us to reinvest. We will continue to reinvest our incremental profits back to our businesses and continue to expand our market leadership in various areas. Before our Q&A session, we would like to announce that our Investor Day will be held on September 28th to 30th. This time, it will be a virtual one due to the pandemic, the limitation on travel people. So we hope to provide in-depth business updates as we did in previous Investor Days. Details will be posted on the Investor Relationship section of Alibaba Group's website. Now we can open up for questions. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen,
for today's call, you're welcome to ask questions in Chinese or English. A third-party translator will provide consecutive interpretation for the Q&A session. And our management will address your questions in the language you asked. Please know that the translation is for convenience purpose only. In the case of any discrepancy, our management statement in the original language will prevail. 大家好, 今天的电话会议欢迎您用中文或英文提问。 我们会有第三方工作人员提供实时的翻译。我们的管理层会按您提问的语言回答您的问题。翻译目的是方便大家理解。如有任何疑义，请以我们管理层原始语言所做的程序为准。Operator, please connect speaker and SI conference line now. Please start Q&A session when ready.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. If you wish to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone now and wait for your name to be announced. If you wish to cancel your request, please press the pound or hash key. To give more people the opportunity to ask questions, please keep yourself to no more than one question at a time. Again, it's star 1 on your telephone and wait for your name to be announced. Your first question comes from the line of Eddie Leung from Bank of America. Please ask your question.
Thank you. 谢谢管理团队。 我们看见 几个大的 电子商务平台, 他们的用户数 包括你们都已经蛮大, 所以蛮大可能 同一个消费者, 他可能都会在几个平台上面购物。 所以我想问一问这, 你们想一想未来的时候, 什么类型的用户, 什么样的情况, 什么样的产品比较大机会会在阿里巴巴上面买呢? 好,这是这样子, 谢谢。
Thank you. My question is, given the existence of several large e-commerce platforms in China in parallel, all of them already being at considerable scale, meaning that there are bound to be some consumers who are on multiple platforms simultaneously. The question is, in the future, what consumers, under what circumstances, and with respect to what products do you see specifically coming to Alibaba's platforms?
我来回答这个问题，这个其实对阿里巴巴来讲, 我们的这个 China Retail Marketplaces, 我们其实为消费者提供的是一个综合的一个服务体验。 这里包括丰富的商品，包括有竞争力的价格，包括完善的这个消费者服务，这个包括售前、售中、售后的服务，所以它是一个完整的一个用户体验，所以它能够满足不同消费者在不同的时刻、在不同品类的这个要求，所以这个我们相信这个阿里巴巴的平台仍然是中国消费者首选的我们的消费平台。
Thank you. I will answer that question. With respect to Alibaba's China retail marketplaces, for consumers, what we offer is an integrated service experience with the widest and richest product assortment, with highly competitive pricing, with excellent service. Service that's provided pre-sale, during sale, and post-sale. And therefore, we're already positioned to meet the needs of all kinds of different consumers in different categories. That's why Alibaba is the number one choice for online shoppers in China, and we'll continue to keep working to keep that the case.
从商家的角度来讲, 这个我们既有这个天猫的这样的品牌的指引, 啊, 这个消费者能够直接购买品牌商, 啊, 这个直接的供给的商品, 特别是新产品, 同时我们也有淘宝这样大量丰富的来自各种渠道的商品, 和这个今天这个来自于原产地, 来自于工厂的产品, 来自于各地的农产品, 所以对消费者来讲, 啊, 其实整个满足他们的需求, 啊, 是可以满足他们不同的需求, 这个第一是满足不同的层次的消费者的需求, 第二是满足消费者在不同的这个品类当中的这个需求, 在有些品类, 啊, 即使是这个有钱的消费者, 他也希望能够更有 更这个价格更便宜更好, 但是在有一些品类, 他们可能更关注服务和品质, 所以在这么巨大的这个用户量下面, 我们希望为不同的消费者, 啊, 提供不同的选择, 满足他们不同的需求。
Secondly, from the merchant perspective, we have Tmall, where brands make their goods available to consumers who can buy goods, in particular new goods, directly from brands. We also have Taobao, where goods are made available through many different channels to consumers, including now with direct sourcing from origin, including of agricultural and food products. So the fact is that we can meet a whole range, the full range of different needs and demands from consumers, both in terms of different categories and products, and also in terms of the range. You know, you can have some consumers who are more affluent, but they could be also looking for value for money offerings, but in other cases they'll be looking for product of higher quality or higher level of service. So our intention is to continue to provide more options and to meet needs in all of those different areas.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you.
Your next question comes from the line of Alicia Yap of Citigroup. Please ask your question.
Hi, good evening, management. Thanks for taking my questions and congrats on the solid results. My question is on your international retail business, especially Lazada. What is your latest view for the e-commerce evolvement in Southeast Asia regions? What are the differentiated approach that you have, your competitive strengths, and any areas that you think there are rooms to change or improve that you foresee how the landscape will evolve, you know, as compared to China and in the region, and how Lazada will position that. Thank you.
晚上好，感谢你们接受我的提问，也祝贺集团本季度又是取得了非常出色的业绩。我的问题呢是有关于国际零售业务，特别是Lazada，想知道你们对于电商业务在东南亚的未来发展有什么样的看法，然后阿里会采取什么样的一个跟别家不同的有差异化的这个战略和方法。 来参与这个市场的这个变化，然后你认为这个市场的变化会与中国或者是区内其他市场有什么样的不同？那么阿里的 Lazada 又会做出什么样的特殊的定位？Thanks,
Alicia. Let me answer this question. I think, as I said in my script, the Southeast Asia market is our strategic priority for Alibaba's globalization strategy. And I think when we look at our Lazada's operation, we expect to build a more tech-driven, AI-driven, sustainable business. Actually, today in this market, the competition is very extensive, and people invest and even sacrifice the buyers, sellers, even shipping fees, and trying to get the short-term growth. But we strongly believe we need to build a long-term sustainable business. And so our advantage is first is about Alibaba technology infrastructure, and especially our experience and know-how and technologies
in the AI and in the search and recommendation and the supply and demand match mechanism. I think this is our big advantage. And after Lazada's business transformation, we are today gaining the benefit from this, I mean, technology implementation. And second, I think as part of Alibaba's operation, we have a big advantage to supply the Southeast Asian market with the goods from China and from other countries. Today, actually, Lazada is not an isolated business to Alibaba. Actually, this is part of Alibaba global network, and we are trying to sell not only from local to local, but also China to Southeast Asia, and other countries to Southeast Asia. And at the end of the day, I think we are trying to build a global network and to sell anywhere, buy anywhere. And the third one, I think today for Lazada, we also have different segments. We have our large mall for brands operation and which provide a high quality product directly from the brands and with good fulfillment delivery services. We have our large Lazada marketplace, which is more like a small B2C or even C2C. And as I said before, we have like large global, which is cross-border business from China and other countries. We will continue to invest and enhance the position of each of the marketplaces and provide an integrated experience to our customers. And as to the difference, I mean, between China market and Southeast Asia market, I would say, I think maybe the biggest difference is that actually in Southeast Asia, social network is very, very popular, and there are a couple of very important players in this market. And merchants also loves to interact with customers via social network. So how to leverage the power of social networks, I think it's a very important goal to us. So actually we have done a lot and we will continue to do further. Thank you.
Good, 谢谢您的问题。在我刚才宣读的准备好的发言当中也是讲到了东南亚的市场是阿里巴巴集团国际化战略当中第一个最重要的最具战略性的这样一个市场。那么在我们 Lazada 的这个运营当中我们会就是使用我们的科技使用我们的人工智能 AI 来打造一个可持续的这样的一个业务来发展。我们已经在广泛的应用我们集团所有这些相关的这个技术。那么在东南亚应该说是竞争很激烈有其他的这个公司他们甚至在做各种补贴买家补贴卖家甚至在补贴物流的方面但是阿里巴巴的心态是坚定的我们希望打造长期可持续的这样的一个业务那我们的优势说一个是我们的技术科技方面的基础设施还有我们的很多专有知识围绕人工智能搜索推荐还有在需求和供给之间的这个撮合匹配等方面这都是很成熟的科技是我们的一个巨大的优势另外的话呢就是说 Lazada 自从这个改制之后已经在受益于我们这样的一些高端的科技那么第二就是说这个我们阿里巴巴对待 Lazada 并不是把它作为一个孤立的业务来看待而是作为我们阿里巴巴这个系统当中的一个组成部分所以我们希望它能够支持呢这个本地对本地中国对东南亚还有其他国家对东南亚的这样的全方位的一体化的这个交易模式阿里巴巴的决心就是打造一个全球化的网络让任何人在任何地方可以进行买和卖那么第三点就是说 Lazada 它也是覆盖不同的市场细分，它有这个大型这个商场啊，它是给品牌来跟这个消费者互动的，还有 Lazada Marketplace 这个等于是一个小企业小 B to C 甚至是 C to C 这样一个市场，那么还有它的 Global 就是中国等其他国家可以利用这样一个市场，那么我们会继续投资发展所有这些不同的市场板块，为客户提供优质的一体化的这个体验。那么最后您还问到东南亚市场发展和中国有什么最大的不同，我认为最大的不同在于东南亚这个社交网络的这个普及度，东南亚的这个消费者非常喜欢用社交网络包括跟商家来进行互动，所以我们的一大课题就是如何利用好社交网络的这个力量来发挥作用，我们这一方面已经做了很多，未来还会继续投入。
Thank you, Daniel.
Your next question comes from the line of Binnie Wong of HSBC. Please ask your question.
Good evening, management. Congrats on a very successful quarter and also on a successful June 18 shopping festival. Question is on the Taobao deals. We saw in news that you soon launch a short video channels to strengthen the ecosystem. And while Douyin on the other side also talking about expanding e-commerce business, making it closed loop. So question is, how do we differentiate when we talk about this live streaming and short video, I guess in the terms of like social commerce, and how do we better help merchants to sustain the relationship longer with customers? And so far, do you see live streaming as cannibalized or incremental to merchants' marketing budget on Alibaba? Thank you.
Thank you. 你们这里推出短视频来丰富相关的这个生态系统，也知道抖音呢，他们在考虑呢增加这个购物消费的这个内容，那么从此形成直接的这种竞争。那么想要知道直播还有社交购物消费这一方面你们怎么看的？然后直播你认为它是可以带来增量的这个消费，还是它是存量消费当中的又一个渠道？谢谢。
Okay, I think first of all, Taobao deals targets value cautious customers by offering high quality products, high quality and value for money products.So I think that the target customers for Taobao deal actually is very, very clear. And as part of the consumer experience in Taobao deal mobile app, we launched the short live streaming and short form video. I think, but this is not complete, user experience. It's part of the consumer interface.But it's, I think that we are trying to give factories and suppliers a tool to manage their customers and also trying to give customers different experiences in their consumer journey on Taobao deal. But I think the primary goal is still segment the Taobao deal with the value for money products and the low-end customers. This is very clear. And the short-form video is just a consumer feature.And this will highly integrate it with the whole entire consumer journey in Taobao Deal mobile app. And in terms of the live streaming, activities in other player, including Douyin, I would say for our merchants, I think live streaming is more like an event marketing and. As part of their entire operation, and people can it's impossible for people to do 7-day, 24 hours live streaming and all the ways. And if you look at the details of live streaming today, actually most of the merchants viewed it as a way to do promotion and acquire new customers. but they do need a sustainable and day-to-day operation platform, which is Alibaba platform. So that's why a lot of merchants, they build their storefront on our platform, and they operate, they're trying to bring all the customers from different ways to Taobao, and because this gives them a best way to operate, and this also gives them a highest ROI in their operation. And for Taobao live streaming, I think we also introduced live streaming in Taobao and Taobao Deal. And as we disclosed, the GMV from Taobao live streaming tripled. I mean, in this quarter, I think this is already is a very important, I mean, consumer feature. But that's not all. That's part of consumer experiences. And because of the incremental traffic generated from the Taobao live streaming, we're also identifying new opportunities for monetizing this, I mean, additional traffic in Taobao live streaming. So, but once again, this monetization model is not a separate one. It's part of the whole solution, entire solution we provide to our merchants to manage their customers on our platform for their entire life cycle.
That's super clear. Thank you, Daniel.
好的，那么我想，淘宝Deal、淘宝特价版，它呢是针对对价格呢比较敏感的客户，给他提供这个高质量、性价比高的这样的一个产品，所以它的目标客群应该是非常的明确。那么为了丰富这个消费者的这个体验，我们是推出了这个直播还有短视频。 但是这些呢，并不代表一个完整的用户体验，它只是用户体验当中的一个部分，也是我们给到商家更多工具来管理他们的这个客户，那么可以结合多种不同的这个工具来进行客户的运营，所以应该说这个短视频也好，还是直播也好，它是一个功能，一个一体化大整体当中的。 一个工具，那么可以丰富这个消费者在淘宝特价版 APP 当中的这个消费旅程。那么说到抖音或其他平台他们的这个直播，我想对我们的商家而言，这个直播呢有点类似于是活动营销，它是一个整体运营当中的一个部分。但是毕竟没有人可以呢每周7天、每天24小时。 不停的去直播，所以的话呢，很多商家他会利用直播来做一些促销，来做一些获客。但是除此之外，他还需要非常稳定强大的一个平台支撑他日常的这个运营。所以很多的商家就是选择利用我们这样的一个平台来到这个淘宝，他也确实发现到淘宝来开店铺。 是非常高效的，然后可以带来最高的投资回报率。那么实际上刚才已经透露了，就是淘宝直播包括这个淘宝特价版这个直播在本季度它带来的这个 GMV 是增加了2倍到原来数目的这个3倍，所以的话呢，它已经是成为了一个非常重要的一个方式，那它仅仅是消费者体验当中的一个。 一个部分，我们也正在寻找新的一些机会，可以对这些流量呢来进行变现。但我强调，它不是一个单独的存在，它是我们整体解决方案当中的一个部分，等于是给到商家多一点的这个工具，可以呢长期可持续的在消费者整个生命周期当中来对它进行管理和运营。
Next question, please.
Operator, next question, please.
Your next question comes from Mark Mahini. Please ask your question.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to ask about the Ali Cloud business. Can you talk about the sustainability of growth there? Are there particular industry verticals that you've recently seen be more aggressive in terms of cloud deployments? And just talk about what's happening in terms of the competitive dynamics, whether pricing remains relatively consistent. You're seeing more aggressive pricing in the industry. Thank you very much.
好，谢谢你的问题。我的问题是关于呢这个阿里云这个业务，想知道它现在这个增长是不是可持续，然后呢在哪些垂直的行业部门，你现在看到这个。 上云的步伐是比较快，然后总体云市场的竞争格局现在怎么样？定价价格是不是很稳定，还是价格有这个竞争的压力在？Cloud
is a fast-growing business. If you look at our revenue breakdown, obviously cloud is enjoying a very fast growth. And what we see is that all the industries are in the process of transformation, digital transformation, and cloud is a very important. I mean, moving to the cloud is a very important step to all the industries, and we strongly believe that sooner or later all the business will move to cloud. So that's why we do see the fast growing growth. We do believe the fast growing will continue in near and midterm, and this in the even in the longer term, this will totally change the how enterprises work and how business collaborated, and in terms of the industry development, even all the industries they are embracing the cloud, but I think that the people who take the first the move farthest first is from the internet company, because all the internet company, all the internet operation actually could be powered by cloud. So internet is a very important sector, but in recent months we do see the fast growth from other sectors, including like financial services. Consumer retail, and even like public sectors, like power and utilities, so on and so forth. So, but we do believe it is still in an early stage, and as I said before, and we don't want to just provide an cloud in terms of infra services. If we just do it as an infra service, as our services. Then price competition is inevitable. And then all the cloud service is more like a commodity business. Today, Alibaba's cloud is cloud plus intelligence services. And it's about cloud plus the power of the data usage. So that's why we work hard to develop industry-specific solutions with IaaS and PaaS services. Together with our SaaS partners, and we will continue to do that to enhance our market leadership.
Okay, 那么实际上所有的产业都在进行数字化的这个改造，那么上云对任何产业来讲都是一个非常重要的一步。我们坚信所有的产业所有的部门都会来上云，所以我们相信就是在近期和中期而言，我们会继续看到快速的增长。那么在长期来说，我们认为上云会彻底改变企业工作的方式，还有企业协作的这个方式。那么谈到产业的发展，所有的这个产业不同的行业都在上云，但确实有些行业它的动作更快。那么通常动作最快的最愿意率先来上云的是互联网的公司，因为互联网企业它的很多很多业务都很容易就可以从云端上来开展，但是最近我们确实也看到其他一些行业他们上云的步伐也是很快，包括有金融服务业，包括呢有这个消费，针对消费者的零售业，还有一些公共部门的服务，包括电力这个等设施的提供，但是这些还是处在早期。我们认为呢，我们的云的服务它绝对不仅仅是一个作为基础设施来提供，所谓 IaaS， 因为如果是纯粹作为 IaaS 来做的话呢，那么价格方面的竞争一定是非常的激烈，我们的产品也无法实现差异化。因此阿里，我上次也强调过，阿里的一个基本的主张是云加智能，要结合数据的这个力量。因此的话呢，我们在大力开发各种不同垂直行业的解决方案，和我们的这个合作伙伴共同合作，然后以这样一种方式来这个维护和提高我们的市场领先地位。
Yeah, Mark, this is Maggie. To supplement what Daniel said, regarding your question on the competition in cloud computing, our peer company who also has cloud businesses, they report their results as well. And I think you can do the comparison, although none of these companies have disclose the cloud computing revenue and the profitability, the P&L, the EBITDA, like we do, but you still can, figure out from, derive the cost revenue from them. Obviously, we're the largest in terms of the business size, so we reported more than 12 billion RMB revenue in one quarter's time. This is more than doubled of our nearest competitor, and we're growing faster. Give you a sense of the,
好，谢谢，我是 Maggie， 我是 Maggie， 然后我想补充回答一下刚才您问到的关于竞争对手的这个问题，那么当然呢，我们有同业的公司，他们也有云方面的业务，你也可以去做比较做分析，虽然他们不像我们会具体披露营运指标，包括 EBITDA 等等，但是你们可以去推算一下，然后自己做一些比较。显而易见的是，阿里云是云市场最大的，我们一个季度就实现120亿人民币的收入，那么这个规模是仅次于我们第二大的公司的两倍多，而且我们还在快速增长。
I would also like to add that if you compare to give you a global comparison of the China cloud market and the U.S. cloud market, based on the third party studies that we've seen, the China cloud market is going to be somewhere in the $15-20 billion. Total size range, and the U.S. market is about 8 times that. So the China market is still at a very early stage,
And we expect, based on what we've seen of our customers, as well as observing the whole market growth, the China market is going to be a much faster growing market in cloud than the U.S. market. So we feel very good, very comfortable to be in the China market and being an environment of faster digitization and faster growth of usage of cloud from enterprises because we're growing from such a smaller base, about one-eighth the base of that of the U.S. market.
我是Joe, 我也想补充一下, 就是说如果拿中国市场跟国际市场啊, 尤其是美国市场来做一个比较的话, 我们从看到的很多分析的报告, 就知道, 中国的这个云市场大概会是在 150亿到200亿美元这样一个规模, 那么美国的云市场呢, 已经是这个数字的8倍有多, 因此的话呢, 中国市场现在是处在一个 初期的发展阶段，那么我们观察我们的客户，观察中国的这个市场，我们相信中国市场一定会有快速的发展，它的速度会比美国更快。因此的话呢，我们现在在中国市场做云业务，我们是感觉很好的，我们认为处在这样一个环境也非常好，因为它无论是数字化的这个推进速度，还是云服务的 这个渗透率提高的速度都是很快，而且原来的基数很低，等于是美国的1%而已，所以未来的前景还是非常广阔的。Operator,
next question, please. Operator, next question. Thank you.
Thank you. Your next question. Thank you. Your next question comes from Yusuf Squali from Truist. Please ask your question.
Great. Thank you. Good morning. Two very quick ones. First, seems like the recovery have been somewhat uneven between higher income and lower income consumers. Daniel, I was just wondering if you believe that as a result of this pandemic, there has been a structural impact on lower income consumers and maybe how long it may take them to recover over time. And second, Maggie, any update to the guidance that you had given last call about the total revenue in fiscal 2021 of more than 650 billion RMB. Thank you.
好，谢谢。早上好，我提两个很短的问题。第一个问题就是，似乎我们看到这次的复苏当中，那么高收入和低收入消费者他们的复苏速度是不平衡的。那么首先想问 Daniel， 你是否认为这次的 这个疫情影响对低收入的消费者是不是带来了结构性的影响？然后如果是，他们的恢复将需要多长时间？那么第二个问题想问 Maggie， 就是对于上次给我们的2020年收入的这个指引目标 6500亿人民币， 你现在是否需要做更新？
Maybe I'll answer first quickly on this revenue guidance, Yusuf. So we grow revenue for June quarter by 34%. We remain the guidance unchanged, although we're very confident in our business because this is just the first quarter of this fiscal year, and there are still three more quarters to go. So we'll update you at due course if there's any update. Thank you.
谢谢，我先回答一下关于这个收入指引方面的问题。刚才已经公告了 六月份季度我们的收入是增长34%，我们现阶段对之前做出的指引是不会做调整或改变的，我们对我们的业务呢是很有信心。那么今年才过去了1/4，我们还有三个季度，那么如果今后需要做更新的，我们会及时通知。
For the consumer segment, I think generally speaking, the recovery of Chinese consumption, I think, actually stay strong. As China is the first country move out of the pandemic, and all the situation is almost under control, except for a couple of cities. So that's why the recovery of the consumption, I think, is quite promising. And if you look at our number and China retail market is reporting a very strong growth in this quarter. Most important thing is that the ASP for the consumers in all city tiers actually grows, and they buy more frequently and they consume more. But if you look further, I agree that for the low-income people, I think they are. If you look at their consumption behavior, actually, there is still some uncertainties because they are actually more cautious about the future of the economy. As you know, that in China, a lot of low-income people from the service sectors, and today, I think, as compared to the physical goods consumption, the consumption in service sectors still takes some time to fully recover, and the employment in this service sector also need more time to recover. So I think this will bring some sort of like uncertainties for these low income group.
好，那么关于这个消费者人群的这个细分，我想首先说的是，总体而言，中国消费的复苏是强劲的。中国是世界上第一个能摆脱疫情影响实现强劲复苏的国家。现在全国各地疫情应该说基本上得到了很有效的控制，除了少数几个城市或地区之外。那么在这个消费的复苏方面，我们看到的情景是令人感到乐观的。刚才也已经公布了我们中国的零售平台这一季度的这个增长是强劲的。而且很重要的一个数据就是在所有层级的城市当中， ASB 比单价都是提高了，购买频次也是提高了，所以人们是买了更多而且买得更频繁。那么如果再更具体的来看我也能够同意说，低收入的这个人群他们有一部分的消费可能依然受到一些不确定性的因素的影响，因此他们可能对于某些消费而言他会更加慎重或者是对未来的经济他会更加的这个谨慎。因为现在很多这些人群他是就业于服务部门，那么服务部门的这个完全的复苏可能还需要过一段时间，那么这个也会部分影响到一些人群的这个服务方面的这个消费。
Operator, next question, please.
Your next question comes from the line of Gregory Zhao of Barclays. Please ask your question.
管理层您好，非常感谢提问机会，同时祝贺您强劲的业绩。我的问题是关于咱们中国互联网的话，在过去这些年涌现出以阿里巴巴为代表的全球领先的巨头，在互联网的应用层面，阿里巴巴以及其他的中国互联网公司已经全面领先了国际上的竞争对手。 但同时在一些基础研究领域，比如说操作系统、半导体芯片等制造方面，中国还处于相对落后的情况。所以想问一下，阿里巴巴在这些关键性的互联网的基础研究领域，有哪些长远的布局和计划？同时的是否意味着，今后阿里巴巴会在全球范围内的人才引进会有所加强？谢谢。
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to ask a question. Congratulations on a strong quarter. So we know that China has produced a number of globally leading internet giants, with Alibaba as the most typical example. And these companies, including Alibaba, are at the front of the entire world in terms of developing all kinds of applications for the internet. But when it comes to things like operating systems or even semiconductors and chips, China lags behind the rest of the world. So my question is, does Alibaba have any longer-term plans to invest in that kind of key infrastructure? And as part of that, does Alibaba have plans to hire more talent from international markets?
谢谢你的问题。对阿里来讲啊，我们一直这么多年一直是以市场导向和用户导向啊来发展我们的业务。啊，在这个中间，我们对关键技术的投入啊也是长期的啊，也是这个坚定的。这个但是我们始终坚信，就是所有的技术最终还是要面对市场啊。我们一直是用消费者业务啊来牵引啊，包括今天走向云的市场也是以这个不是简单的这个云服务的提供，也是以这个最终为企业在真正的这个改善经营管理上面提升效率方面能够提供服务。所以这个是我们这个坚定的这个方向。我们也有对长期的这个技术的投入啊，包括在通过我们的达摩院啊，我们也在进行很多的研究和，但是我们坚信啊，这个研究和发展这个 research and development 必须高度的结合啊，这样才能够为商业啊，为社会创造啊真正的价值。谢谢。
Thank you. Alibaba has always been committed to market-oriented and user-oriented development, and we continue to invest for the long term in technology with those objectives in mind. We believe that all technology must be tightly integrated with the market to meet needs in the market. We've done that with consumer-facing technology and now also with the cloud, where we're not just providing infrastructure but are looking for ways to leverage on the cloud to help businesses enhance their operations and become more effective. So certainly this is our commitment. We're committed to long-term investment and to doing research through our Damwa Academy, among others. But we do believe very strongly that research and development should be highly integrated in order to create value for society.
Thank you very much.
Operator, next question.
Your next question comes from the line of Jin Yu from New Street Research. Please ask your question.
Hi, good evening. Hey, thanks for taking my question. Maggie, I think in your prepared remarks, you talked about reinvestments back into the business, the profits reinvestment back into the business. Can you just kind of talk about the scale and scope of kind of what that investments look like and the duration and how we should be thinking about the rest of the fiscal year in terms of when some of these investments will hit? Thanks again.
谢谢。我的问题想问 Maggie， 刚才您在准备好的发言当中提到有一部分的利润是在投资于你们的业务发展，能不能详细介绍这些在投资的规模和范围，还有实现，然后剩下的财年当中不同的季度大概会按照什么样的一个速度来开展？
Sure, let me answer your question. First of all, as you can tell that we have very strong profit generation power, right? So if you look at the adjusted EBITDA for this one quarter, we have generated over 50 billion RMB profit. So we use that part of that profit to reinvest back to develop a business, while other people use the investors' money to invest back. So that's number one. Number two, in terms of to what extent, I think we got a lot of questions on, you know, you're talking about cost control, efficiency. Does that mean that you are very cautious in terms of investing in marketing, in, you know, user acquisition, et cetera? The answer is not necessarily. You know, we are very committed to further expand not only the user base, but also enhance the user engagement, but also, you know, their increase the stickiness of these users and provide with them with broader products and services. So when you look at the marketing, those in the marketing costs, we're investing over like 13 billion sales marketing in one quarter time. It's not a small number. However, as a
Maggie, 我们听不见您的声音, 你可以打开话筒吗?
Operator, could you please take the next question? Operator, can you hear us?
This is Maggie. Maybe let me summarize what I just answered to Jane's question. With the strong revenue and profit growth, we're going to continue reinvest back to these strategically important businesses. I think our investment aims to for a longer term, healthy and sustainable growth.
好，大家好，我是 Maggie。刚才技术问题，我再总结一下我刚才说的重点内容，就是说我们现在有着强劲的收入和盈利的增长，那么借此呢，我们将会进行再投资，投资于战略重要性的新的业务的发展。我们这些业务都旨在推动长期可持续健康的增长。Operator, could we have the next question, please?
Thank you. Your next question comes from Colin Sebastian from BERT. Please ask your question.
Great. Thanks, and congratulations on the quarter. Two quick ones for me as well. First off, Daniel, I think you mentioned a change in strategy in India. If maybe you could talk in a little more detail about the platform's opportunities in that market. And then secondly, looking at the gap between the mobile MAUs and the total active commerce user base, the gap has increased a bit, and I'm wondering if that's an opportunity over time to engage those mobile monthly users that are not yet active customers. Thank you.
好，谢谢也祝贺你们很出色的一个季度业绩我也提两个很短的问题。第一个问题呢，就是刚才 Daniel 提到公司在印度战略的一个调整，能不能稍微展开介绍未来你们的平台在印度市场有什么样的机会？第二个问题呢，就是我们注意到这个移动端的月活跃用户它和这个零售平台上的这个活跃买家的这个数量之间这个差距的这个拉大，那是不是意味着有机会可以更好的来与这些还不是买家的这个用户进行更多的互动？
First of all, as I said, we decided to stop operations of UC Web and other innovation initiatives in India after our business review.And we believe that globalization is our long-term strategy. But in near term, I think we are closely monitoring the change of the geopolitical environment and also the national policy of other countries. And we will adjust our strategies, according to this change.For the second question, I would say today our MAU and AAC still have a very strong growth given we have such a huge size of consumer base in China. But I think most important thing is that we have people engage with us. That's the starting point. And if you look at our historical number, you will see that the longerpeople stay with us, the more spending they will do, and the more consumption they will do, and the more categories they will consume. So we will continue to engage with customers and to convert the the visitors, the new customers into our royalty buyers in the long run.
Thank you.
好，像我在发言当中所说，我们是经过对相关业务的审核之后，决定在印度呢停止我们 UC Web 还有其他创新的业务。那么全球化是阿里巴巴长期的战略，但是我们也要去看当前环境的变化，包括地缘政治环境的变化，还有相关各国它的国家政策的一个变化。那么相应的呢，我们会调整自己的这个战略。那么第二个问题，实际上我们的 MAU 还有 AAC 这个数字都显示出有快速的强劲的这个增长，尤其是考虑到我们本来这个用户的这个基础规模非常的庞大，但是最重要的还是人们与我们平台的一个互动。那么从我们的发展的历史来看，人们在我们平台待的时间越长越多，那么他会消费越多，而且他消费的品类会是越多，所以我们会继续来和我们这些用户呢做好互动，让用户呢长期成为我们的有忠诚度的高频次的消费者。Next question, please.
We are now going to take the last question. Your last question comes from Puyush Mubayi from Goldman Sachs. Please ask your question.
Thank you for taking my question. And congratulations on a good set of numbers. May I just take a step back and look at COVID and the aftermath of COVID? I wanted to understand from you if there were specific areas that you saw an increased opportunity emerge, and would that lead to a change in tactic? We did notice that your 618 period, you were much more aggressive and it bore fruit very, very quickly for you. And we wanted to understand if those two can be read together and we can see an emergence of potentially a much more aggressive stance from you that would bear fruit over time. That's my question.
好，这是最后的问题。我想还是问一下宏观的方面，就是疫情过后你是不是认为有哪些特定的领域会有更多新的机会这个增长更好一些机会，如果有的话，你会不会相应的调整一下你们的一些策略，比如说这次的618我们看到你们有些做法呢做得比以前更激进，那么是不是也说明未来的一个新的一个做法？
I think this pandemic changed fundamentally people's lifestyle and changed how enterprises work. And if you look at the consumption sector, I would say after the pandemic, people care more about the health, and that's why we see the healthcare categories grows very fast. But I think that's not all. And we do see a lot of increasing opportunities in FMCGs, in new brands, and also in many sectors. And also from the retail perspective, I think all the retail operations moving to the digital sector, I mean, move to digital operation. So how to leverage the power of our new retail infrastructure to help these merchants to serve their customers on a local basis. I think this is a growing opportunity. And the cloud, we said many times, and cloud is a big wave, and we are still in the early stage in terms of the fast growing. And I think 618 is as a mid-year campaign is part of our annual operation, and we think we take the right approach and to meet the growing meet the demand and grow emerging demand of the consumers I think post pandemic, and also meet the demand of the suppliers who want to sell more products and deliver more services to their customers. So we are happy to see the good results, and we will continue to create value for both our customers and the merchants.
Yeah. 这次的疫情, 深刻地改变了人们的生活方式, 以及企业运营的, 方式。 先看消费, 当然在疫情过后, 人们对这个健康品类更加的 重视，因此的话呢， 在健康这个品类， 我们看到， 增长变得更加的快速， 但是， 远远不只是这样， 我们还看到很多很多快速发展的机会， 包括在， 快消品， 新的品牌， 还有其他很多的领域， 都有这样的机会。 在零售， 这一方面的话呢， 现在所有的， 零售的各种运营 都在进行数字化的升级。 那么如何 利用好我们阿里的新零售的基础设施， 帮助商家可以更好地为本地的客户 提供更好的服务， 做好运营， 这也是一个巨大的机会。 那么第三个巨大的机会， 我们也一直在说， 说过很多次， 就是云业务， 它是处在发展的初期， 而且未来这个增速 一定会是非常的快。 那么说到618这个是我们年终的这样一个活动，它也是我们一年的总体规划当中的一个部分。我们认为呢，我们这次采取的方式是正确和恰当的，可以很好的适应消费者他们新的一些需求，也可以更好的服务商家他们的需求，他们希望能够 买更多的产品服务给到他们的目标客群，所以我们很高兴看到这次取得了良好的这个效果。未来的话呢，我们也会继续来为我们的消费者以及为我们的商家来创造更多的价值。
Yeah, Piyush, as you observe that during this June 18 shopping festival, we together with the local government and together with our merchant partners, has invested billions of RMB in consumer coupon subsidies to stimulate domestic consumption. And you asked us whether we're going to continue the aggressive investment. I think I would put it in this way. We'll be aggressively invest into the business to expand our market leadership. At the same time, we also want to invest smartly, aggressive and smartly. Smartly means that, you know, we're aiming to in long-term sustainable growth rather than just, you know, temporarily acquire customers and GMVs. So the investment going to be focused on user-based growth, also engagement, also retention, also by saying smart, it also means that we're going to leverage the resources from the whole Alibaba economy, which includes us and Ant, and together to grow our business. Thank you.
好，那么像这次的618当中， 您也看到了，我们是联合地方政府和商家， 投入了几十亿元， 给消费者呢提供了消费券， 以这种补贴的方式来刺激国内的消费。 那我们会不会继续做大力的投资？ 答案当然是我们会继续的大力的投资， 来提高我们市场领先地位。 但是我们也是做聪明的投资， 是大力而聪明的投资。 意思就是说我们要 推动长期可持续的高质量的增长， 而不是 来刺激短期的获客， 短期内推GMV的增长。 因此我们的投资会集中在增长用户数规模， 提高互动， 包括这个客户的保持， 维系。 聪明的投资还意味着我们会利用 所有系统中的生态系统中的各种资源， 包括我们自己的资源， 蚂蚁的资源， 共同 合作来提高我们的领先地位。
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes today's conference call. Thank you for participating. You may now disconnect your lines.